Yeah, please go
Now
ahead.
you
Please
have
go
to
ahead.
make full screen a slideshow format, ma. Go to the first slide.
Make it
Press
full
it.
screen.
Is it visible, sir?
Yes, I have to make it full screen.
Can you come to the lower screen,
yeah,
and right side
I
there is
call.
One. Ah, yeah, there
I
you
call.
click there.
My what we edit jesi school lo ne vidhanga edit chesamo anantaram add by click chesthe aa vivaralu namo daru.
We have any challenges, Dr. Harsh?
It's not just
you just press F5, Dr. Harsh.
Just press F5.
Yeah.
Yes, good. Good luck, Harsh. Please start.
Thank you, sir. The patient profile: a 60-year-old married Muslim male, an auto rickshaw driver, residing at Ahmedabad, Gujarat, belonging to upper middle socioeconomic status, admitted on the 30th February 2021 and was examined on the 18th February 2021 with complaint of vomiting since 12 days, fullness in upper abdominal region since 12 days. History of presenting illness: patient was apparently well 12 days ago. Then he developed vomiting, 1 to 2 episodes per day, after 3 to 4 hours of meal, non-bilious, non-blood stain, non-projectile, containing food particles, preceded by nausea. Patient had one episode of vomiting, bilious in a character, with sudden severe agonizing epigastric pain, radiated into back, 3 months ago in the evening time. They went to local hospital, where some IV drugs were given, and advised to go for ultrasound abdomen. After that, patient came to our hospital and get admitted. Patient was treated as acute pancreatitis by treating consultant. Meanwhile, patient was diagnosed COVID positive, so was shifted to civil hospital and treated there. Patient noticed fullness in the upper abdomen with mild discomfort in the midline, sudden in onset, initially small in size in umbilical region, gradually increased in a size and later covered epigastric region also. It was associated with early satiety, no aggravating relieving factor. On the second day of admission, patient had bilious vomiting, so RT was inserted. Around 250 ml of greenish fluid came in the 24 hours for the 3 consecutive days, according to the relatives. Then gradually it becomes yellowish in color with reduced amount. Patient is on antacid since 3 years. Patient has associated history of weight loss, which is told by the patient in the form of loosening of clothes in 20 days, decreased appetite, and postprandial heaviness. There is no history of hematemesis malignant, no passing clay color stool, no yellowish discoloration of eye, no similar complaints in other family members, no trauma to the abdomen, no altered bowel habits. The past history: patient is a known case of hypertension since 6 years, and he is taking tablet Telmiride 40 once a day. Patient is on tablet Atorvastatin 1 HS and patient on tablet Ecosprin, but he is off to treatment since 5 days. There was history of trauma 4 years back on the right forearm. Patient was fall down and was treated for the same. Patient got fracture in the forearm and patient was operated for that. The negative past history: no tuberculosis, no blood transfusion, no previous abdominal surgery, diabetes, jaundice. Personal history: diet, patient is mixed, appetite reduced since illness started, sleep, patient is having adequate sleep, bowel habits normal, bladder habits normal, patient having no any addiction. General examination: patient is conscious, cooperative, and well oriented.
Stop. Are you done with the history?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you summarize your history once?
Yes, sir. A 60-year-old male Muslim patient non-alcoholic, belonging to upper socio-economic status, came to the hospital with the chief complaint of vomiting since 12 days and upper abdominal fullness since 12 days. Vomiting was non-bilious, non-projectile, non-blood stain, containing food particles. Past history of similar complaint, which was treated as acute pancreatitis. Patient with upper abdominal fullness with increasing size in midline.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us why have you asked about history of alcohol consumption, history of trauma, history of loss of weight, loss of appetite? Can you explain?
Patient is maybe because patient is having vomiting, patient is due to compression, patient is not consuming proper food, and patient may develop the decreased appetite.
Patient, what is the age of the patient?
Patient is old age, sir, 60-year-old
male. Yeah. So what should strike you first when the patient complains of loss of weight and loss of appetite?
Then we can suspect any growing tumor or malignancy.
Yes. Okay. History of alcoholism, how is it important?
Alcoholism usually as a cause of pancreatitis, patient had history of acute abdomen, upper abdomen epigastric pain 3 months back. So it could be the cause that alcohol may have caused the pancreatitis, and in the sequelae of event, patient may have developed the swelling.
Trauma?
Trauma, usually patient had trauma, but it was, I asked the patient, it was not the abdominal trauma, patient just got the injury. But if there is a abdominal injury and patient admitted with severe abdominal pain, it may have caused the pancreatic injury, blunt abdominal injury may have caused the pancreas damage, which may be the cause of acute pancreatitis.
You mentioned that the patient was detected COVID positive.
Yes, sir. Patient detected COVID positive.
Do you get commonly nowadays, especially we are seeing many patients with pain in abdomen and a lump? So what is the common cause nowadays in COVID era? Those patients who are under treatment in ICUs many times.
Yes, sir.
You got my question?
No, sir. Can you pardon me, sir?
Yeah, COVID positive patient who is under treatment.
Yes, sir.
Complains of pain in abdomen.
Yes,
and
sir.
Has a palpable lump.
Yes, sir.
So, what is the common cause usually? This is commonly seen nowadays in ICU. Any idea?
I don't know, sir.
Nowadays we are getting many patients of rectus hematoma.
Yes, okay.
And very, very big hematoma, even palpable big lump.
Yes, sir.
That is the important consideration.
Okay.
Fine. Sridhar, sir, please.
So what are your conclusions after this history?
One moment. Say you have been specifically asking, telling that Muslim patient is it has any relation with the with your provisional diagnosis?
No, sir. Here it won't be any relation.
So there is no relation. So there is no need to specifically tell his religion.
Okay.
Unless you attribute it to some, it contributes to the diagnosis, sir.
Yes.
You do not mention.
Yes. Okay. Suppose if you are presenting a carcinoma penis case or something like that, so he's a non-Muslim or something like that, you can tell like that.
Yes,
but here is it has no relevance at all, I feel.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right.
So what is your conclusion after this history?
In the form of conclusion, patient is having vomiting and upper abdominal fullness. With patient had history of sudden epigastric pain, one episode 3 months back, and bilious vomiting. So we can suspect there is a upper abdominal pathology.
for abdominal pathology only. That is not the way to tell. You need to tell that there is an episode of one episode of severe pain abdomen. Okay. Probably it may be acute pancreatitis. Followed by
Dr. Harsha.
Yes, sir.
Patient is elderly patient. So yes, I'm just want to know from you, why not it carcinoma pancreas? Just want to ask you. Can you please?
Yes, sir, it can be cause of carcinoma pancreas, but the patient is in very acute events.
Just one or two questions. How many times he had that severe pain radiating to the back?
It was just a one episode 3 months back.
It was only one episode.
Yes.
So your answer should be that that was only one episode, no? So
what
are the causes of pain radiating to the back with the upper abdominal pathology?
First of all, it could be acute pancreatitis, which classically radiate to the back.
Yes.
The second cause is it could be patient is having a known case of gastritis because patient is taking PPI.
Gastritis, why does it cause pain radiating to the back?
Duodenal ulcer.
Duodenal ulcer won't get pain radiating to the back. Okay. If you were to tell gastric ulcer, posterior penetration can give rise to pain in the back.
Yes, sir.
I wanted your answer. Acute pancreatitis, chronic pancreatitis, some large tumors of the pancreas.
Yes, sir.
Also give rise to one attack radiating to the back. They may be pressing on the stomach. Just keep it in mind. Keep it in mind, all this possibility. Why not a stone in the CBD? You have given the history, but just want to rule out? Rule out?
Patient will have colicky abdominal pain.
He had severe pain radiating to the back. Back can be shoulder blades also. So what is the other thing which you have mentioned? Negative important point. Yes.
There is no fever and a jaundice history.
No jaundice. You try to rule out like that when the examiner asks a question. Sir.
Go ahead.
That's about asking about the religion. I think it is very important. Because, you know, there is one condition especially occurred during the Roja period.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And during the Roja period, the Muslim patients, they can present with severe pain in abdomen along with the vomiting.
Yes, sir.
You know, they are known to have the volvulus. There may be a small bowel volvulus may be there, or even the gastric volvulus may be there, which is known to be featured in the persons who are on Roja. You know, Roja means for a prolonged fasting, which is there.
Yes, sir.
They can have this. So I think there is no harm in asking about the religion of this patient in terms of your patient that there is pain in abdomen along the vomiting is there.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah. That is my impression. Yeah. Yeah. You can go ahead. Yeah.
Please go ahead.
General examination. Patient is conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Patient is examined in a valid room with a due concern. Patient is well-nourished with body mass index of 21.13 kilogram per meter square. Vitals, temperature, patient is afebrile vitals, pulse 120 per minute in the right radial artery in sitting position. Regular with normal tension and volume. Blood pressure was 102. 70 millimeter of mercury taken in the right upper limb in sitting position. Respiratory rate 12 per minute. Clubbing present. No pallor, no icterus, no cyanosis, no lymphadenopathy, no edema, no fullness in a left supraclavicular fossa. Per abdomen examination, inspection on the supine position. There is fullness in the epigastrium with a visible space between it and the subcostal margin with visible pulsation over it. On head rest test, swelling reduced slightly. Umbilical central inverted and distal inferiorly. All quadrants of abdomen move equally with the respiration. Scar mark present over the left iliac fossa, which is flat, healed, and brown in a color. Visible scar just above the left subcostal region with a swelling of 2x2 cm having punctum. Inspection, continues. Peroneal sides normal, inguinal and femoral, no dilated veins, mild renal angus normal. On head raise, reduction in the size of lung, no visible peristalsis. This is a swelling on the left lateral and the right lateral aspect. On the palpation, no local rise in the temperature or the tension. Site of the swelling, epigastric region extending vertically, upper border 5 cm from the ziphy sternum, lower border 1 cm above the umbilicus. Lateral borders from the midline to the left, it is 8 cm, and from the midline to the right, it's 5 cm. The approximately size 18 by 30 cm. Consistency form, smooth surface, globular, non-tender, regular margin, well-defined borders, although less defined on the left side of the midline and upper border. Swelling does not move with the respiration. On lateral equipitous position, it falls inside. No intrinsic mobility present. Transmitted pulsation present over the lung. No evidence of organomegaly. No guarding. No rigidity. No succussion plus hold. On percussion, impaired resonant note over the lung. Rest of the abdomen is stimpy. Liver span 11 cm in the mid clavicular line with normal liver dullness. On auscultation, bowel sounds heard specifically over the right ilia fossa. Normal peristalsis heard. External genitalia found to be normal. There is no any abnormality present. The perrectal examination is found to be normal. Nothing significant. Cystic examination. Respiratory system, air entry bilaterally equal. No foreign sounds heard. Cardiovascular examination. Both the heart sounds were normal. No murmur. Patient was fully conscious, cooperative, CCS 15 by 15. So my case summary, 60-year-old male presented with the vomiting since 12 days with similar complaints 3 months back, managed conservatively at that time, followed by development of the lung involving the epigastric and umbilical region since 12 days, non-tender, smooth surface, forming consistency, non-mobile, and becoming less prominent on the head raising test. No movement with the respiration and otherwise normal general systemic examination.
So why have we come to a diagnosis of pleurisy of pancreas?
First of all, the patient had a past history of acute pancreatitis. Suggestive of acute pancreatitis. And patient.
How do we know that it was acute pancreatitis? So just an episode of pain. Relating
yes.
to back, that's all.
Yes, sir. Patients are underwent the ultrasonography and patient admitted in the hospital before the patient developed the swelling.
Oh, see, we are still in history and examination part. We don't have any investigations yet.
Yes, sir.
Okay, with us. So you have to put a clinical diagnosis. So I feel you should have put a differential diagnosis over. So what can be a differential
diagnosis? It could be some cystic neoplasm of the pancreas as compared to patient age. It could be liver pathology involving the left lobe of liver. Could be hydrated cyst.
No. What do you mean by liver pathology? You have to be specific when you mention diagnosis. Yeah. It has to be some specific. Liver pathology can be anything.
It could be some liver cyst, hydrated cyst or malignancy from the left lobe of liver.
Hydrated cyst. We are considering a lump.
Yes, sir.
Which is intra-abdominal.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Probably cystic.
Yes, sir.
With very well defined margin.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is not moving with respiration and which has transmitted pulsation. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So how do you know that the pulsations were transmitted and not extensive?
Sir, we can rule out by two finger test.
Okay.
Or it can be ruled out by the knee elbow position for the especially the abdomen system.
Fine. You are sure that it is not moving with respiration?
Yes, sir. It was not moving with the respiration.
So, what other differential diagnosis? Yes, you have mentioned it. Gastric carcinoma.
Gastric carcinoma it could be retroperitoneal cyst. It could be omental cyst.
Harsha, yes, there are two things important here. When you give a differential diagnosis, at least something should match. You can't give a cyst as a diagnosis and you say gastric carcinoma, which is a hard and irregular one. Yes, you sir. Say that mass is, I have seen your picture, it is much, much below the costal margin.
Yes, sir.
It does not move the respiration and you brought liver pathology. What do you mean by liver pathology? It won't fit in with the liver pathology. So what we are trying to tell is, yes, it does not move the respiration, intra-abdominal, pulsations present, nice, whatever you're finding. So keep something which is somewhere in that area, like your cystic neoplasm, very well accepted.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
retroperitoneal is also accepted.
Okay.
They may ask you, why not a nodular lymph nodal mass in that area or a carcinoma body of the pancreas? This is how elderly man, you can have a pancreatic mass which is nodular, that pulsations are present, loss of weight, can have a backache. So, but you can't give liver pathology, gastric carcinoma like that. This is how you analyze. This is my view, sir. Please.
Your palpatory and percussion findings, you go back to those slides. Yes. What about the percussion on the swelling? Was it dull or resonant?
It was an impaired resonant. It was not the proper resonant sound.
So was it continuous with the liver dullness?
Sir, it was not continuous with the liver dullness.
So there is no question of you mentioning liver and differential diagnosis. And similarly, could you insinuate the fingers between the swelling and costal margin? It is very much away from the costal margin in the inspection itself.
Yes.
You have told. So there is no question of talking about mentioning about the liver at all.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't arise.
Examiner may ask you differential diagnosis, sir. That does not mean, for example, right aleic fossa. That does not mean you give 25 differential diagnosis. That is, in your case, what is nearer to two or three differential diagnosis you have to give. This is how. Wants to tell, sir. Please.
You know, on general examination, you said that afebrile by touch. What is that?
So usually with the dorsum of the hand, we assess the temperature.
You take the body temperature by that?
No, so usually we take the proper temperature with the...
Yeah, you have to use the thermometer.
Thermometer, yes, sir.
Okay, you can say for the local examination.
Yes, sir.
Okay, not for the assess the patient fever, right?
Yes, sir.
And then you said that all coordinates are moving equally with the respiration. Can that happen?
Corresponding.
No, they cannot. It is just the corresponding things which are there. No?
Yes, sir.
And then you said the lateral bend, it falls inside. What does that mean?
Yes.
Somewhere mentioned that. It falls inside on the lateral bend. What is that?
It is usually, sir, if we can't perform the knee elbow position, we can assess that if a swelling is intra-abdominal or parietal, then if it is falling or not in the left decubitus position.
Then it goes in the favor of intra-peritoneal,
sir. Yes, sir.
What does that mean?
That means swelling is intra-abdominal, not from the parietal region.
No, you do it for later.
It is to differentiate between a retroperitoneal and the intraperitoneal. And then you said the patient has the clubbing. How do you explain the clubbing in this patient?
Actually, sir, pancreas, there is no clubbing in the pancreatic disease, but as such in some GI diseases, clubbing is present. In this patient, clubbing was present.
So how do you explain the clubbing in this patient? Is it significant?
It could be due to other system also. If patient is in old age, if we not look on the only abdominal condition.
Don't say old age repeatedly, man. Better say any lung disease, no?
Lung disease, yes, sir, lung disease.
So you have to say like that. So rather than telling, so old age, everybody will not develop a clubbing. You understand?
Yes, sir. Lung pathology, lung disease.
Common is lung pathology, if at all. Then if any other things are there, you say, sir, what answer you wanted, sir? Khanna, sir?
No. Yeah, he must have examined the respiratory system properly. You know? You should have given a, because once you are saying the clubbing is there, you should have done a good respiratory examination in this patient. Yeah.
The
pulsatile, the pulsations are present. And how do you differentiate whether it is a transmitted or expansile in the abdomen?
We can either perform, sir, knee-elbow position.
Okay, knee-elbow is okay, but what you were telling about the two-finger test, it is not
correct. Two-finger test. Yeah, it is.
That is not correct for the abdominal lump.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Big lump,
sir,
which are there, it is not correct. It is only for the extremities, like a radial artery aneurysm is there. You want to put only two fingers and see whether it is going away or not, you know? Only in that, but not in the abdominal lump. In the abdominal lump, either you have to make the patient left lateral or in the knee elbow to differentiate whether it is a transmitted pulsation or the expansile pulsation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Shana, please go ahead. Yeah.
There is one more swelling I saw in the figure above that, the costal margin. What is that, Dr. Harsha?
Sir, patient had that swelling 4 years back and the patient got operated. Patient underwent the excision of the swelling and it again recurs.
You know, I can tell the diagnosis now without examining. What is the diagnosis?
It is sebaceous cyst.
It looks like sebaceous cyst.
Yeah, it has punctum. It was in punctum all that. It is sebaceous.
So it would have recurred probably. Why it has recurred? Now, we have asked this question last time. Now we'll ask you why it has recurred. Quick. Probably some part of the wall was probably
left. Yes,
might have been left behind. Yeah, that is known recurrence. All right, please go ahead.
Dr. Harsha.
Yes, sir.
Can this be a big epigastric hernia with divarication?
It can be. It can be present, but sir, then.
No. See, it cannot be. We'll have to defend that. You have examined the patient already, so you know finding.
Yes,
sir. How do you defend that it is not an epigastric hernia with dilatation? We cannot have all the diagnoses together. As sir said,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you have to give some few specific differential diagnoses. So how will you rule out, in other words, how will you rule out epigastric hernia with dilatation over here?
We can have, sir, cough impulse test or, sir, on the head raising test, the swelling will be prominent.
Yes. Okay. What else?
We can even palpate the defect from the fat or omentum which is coming out. We can palpate the defect properly.
Yeah, if it is reducible.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Go ahead.
So, elderly patient like this, non-alcohol and no trauma, no predisposing factor for pancreatitis, maybe other than the COVID issue and other things. So that is why we want to you to understand, we give a differential diagnosis which is relevant to the case. You know, so acute pancreatitis with the pseudocystis, your diagnosis accepted.
Yes,
but
sir.
Then keep in mind, elderly people, cystadenoma is common in men or women?
It's common in certain women.
It's common in women. Okay. Cystadenomas. Okay.
Yes,
but still, men also can get. Not that.
Yes,
then,
sir.
Of course, I still consider the possibility of a malignancy also. Not as in the lower order, nearer the pancreas. So, your differential diagnosis should go somewhere there. Not carcinoma, stomach and liver. That is not accepted.
Okay, sir.
Please go ahead.
So, what do you want to do now? How do you want to proceed?
We can go for the blood investigation. Basic.
Tell me the line one by one.
Okay.
How do you want to evaluate this case?
In the blood investigation, I would like to go for total count and hemoglobin level. Then I can go for the liver function test. A liver function test, serum bilirubin, serum amylase and serum lipase, serum calcium, then serum lipid profile. We can go for the RFT with electrolyte.
Harsha, just small interference before we go to ultrasound. you are in a government setup or private, doesn't matter. But do you expect amylase lipase very high in this patient? Serum amylase and lipase?
Sir, it could be high, but it could be normal also.
No, could be is different. Does he have, only once you said he has got that acute attack. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So do you get amylase lipase high in this patient usually?
No, sir. Not in this case.
So what? Only that cyst fluid may have a high.
Yes, sir.
So I just want you to understand. First, you say ultrasound, man. First, get ultrasound. Then you work on all those lipase, calcium. Why do you want it? Calcium.
Sir, calcium, hypercalcium could be a cause of acute pancreatitis. So here there is no alcohol and other history. So.
Okay, that I will accept because of the no other history is available. Mm. You wanted to rule out hyperparathyroidism.
Yes, sir. Right?
But yes, did you, if that is in the mind, did you mention in the neck examination no lump felt there? You need to examine. Okay. Yeah, please. Please go ahead. Yes.
Then I would like to go for ultrasound examination of abdomen. In ultrasound examination, I would like to see the origin of the swelling, size of the swelling, and other organs I can see the biliary tract.
Okay.
Now correct. First, you talk about the whatever your diagnosis.
Yes,
what
sir.
Is that thing you look in that area? First, you talk about that. Second, origin of the cyst due to what? Suppose, so did you mention about gallstones? That is one of the important things to mention.
Yes, sir.
Then effects of the cyst, surrounding, pancreas, peritoneal cavity. So all that these details need to expect. Tell me one by one.
First of all, I will see the site and size of the swelling. Is whether it is from the head, body, or tail of the pancreas.
Go ahead. I'm listening. Yes.
The pancreas. Then to see whether it is cystic or solid. Then to look for any other collection besides in the main swelling in the adjacent areas.
So you want to know unilocular or
multilocular.
Much it is compressing the stomach. Or whether it is duodenum or mesocolon, it is pushing down.
Yes.
Solid components or cystic components.
Yes, sir.
If there's solid component, what does it tell you? This is a pseudocyst. I agree with you.
Yes, sir.
Suppose a lot of solid components are there.
Yes, sir.
What are the things you need to keep it in mind now?
Then
just two, three possibilities, no? At least when you yes.
It could have got infected and abscess has been formed or necrosis could occur.
Anything else?
Then solid component could be a malignant stain.
Yes. Okay. Please go ahead.
How about the wall thickness? Would you like to know that?
Yes, sir. Wall thickness. We can ultrasonography. Wall thickness is like.
Yes. And distance again. Of course, we'll further investigate. But distance from the nearby stomach, duodenum.
Yes, sir. Area of abutment. We have to see. Yes. Which are the organs or the compressed by the swelling?
Fine. Go ahead.
Then I will look for the biliary tree if there is any gallstone or not as a cause of gallstone pancreatitis.
Yes, important. Yes.
Then condition of the lymph node. I can see the lymph node and the condition of blood vessels also. Any collaterals are there or not?
Why did you bring suddenly now lymph nodes into discussion now in your case? Tell me. Hello?
Sir, if you... yes, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, tell.
Sir, if you are suspecting the solid component with the carcinoma, etiology as a carcinoma, then we can
unless examiner asks you, don't get into trouble, because you are, we are only concentrating your case now. Okay. We'll ask you this question. I want you to understand large cyst can compress splenic vein thrombosis. Yes, so pseudoaneurysm, definitely this is not the choice of investigation, but you can make out and hemorrhage inside the pseudocyst, solid component. So these are the information you need to get. Collaterals, why did you mention collaterals? What collaterals? You mentioned collaterals, no? Just now.
Yes, sir.
What collaterals? Where?
Sir, it is due to splenic vein thrombosis.
So you knew, but you did not answer. Okay. So you need to know whether patient has developed left-sided portal hypertension. Splenic vein thrombosis. So first you talk about the cyst wall, all that things. Then relation to the organs. Then etiology, gallstone factor, most very important here, especially in this paper patient. And then, of course, splenic vein thrombosis, etc., etc.
Yes,
next, what is the next? Any report is available?
Yes, sir. I have seen the CT scan.
Go ahead.
This is a plate of the CT scan.
Yeah, that report we can't read, have to read, but picture is also,
Yes, sir. It has been modified by the radiologist due to some corrections.
That's okay. But whenever you show the CTs next time, for those who are listening, all right, you put one, show the CT picture, image. Show this once, later one or two images you crop and make it big and show. Understand?
Yes, sir.
So, need to... So, there are no solid components, correct?
Yes, sir. No solid components.
Harsha?
Yes, sir.
Which may not be relevant now, I would like to ask one question because somebody asked in a chat box, vertebrogastric angle. In fact, our time, they used to do one test. What is this? Can you tell me? Actually, vertebrogastric interval we used to teach. What is that? Can you tell me?
It is usually, sir, to whether check the displacement of the stomach by the pseudocyst of pancreas.
So when ultrasound was not available, you give barium.
Yes, sir.
And check between the distance between the vertebral column and stomach.
Stomach, yes, sir.
So if that is more, they used to tell then this is a pseudocyst, not a liver cyst or something like that.
Yes, sir.
So that is what they may ask. Yes.
So when you go through the CT finding, what important things you would like to note?
First of all, regarding the cyst itself, I would like to see the wall thickness, the component of the swelling, then origin, whether there is a single or a multiple cyst. Then I would like to see the connection of the cyst with the duct. Then the cyst, which is, if it is abutting any surrounding structures like a stomach or the duodenum or the bile duct, CBD or the
colon. Why is it important?
Because it will guide us in our treatment according to the abutment, the structure it is causing.
That's why you should know how much area. What is the gap between these two structures, that is this wall and the bowel wall?
Yes, sir.
You have to find out that. If given a choice, would you prefer MRCP or would you prefer CT scan in this case?
I would prefer a CT scan, sir.
Why?
Because MRI is when actually we are suspecting if duct is not properly visualized or any distorted or any history of injury over there?
Not necessarily. What is the opinion of the house? Other professors, what do they say? Dr. Shenoy and Dr. Sridhar, what do you think?
I think CT scan is the initiation of choice.
Fine. If given a choice for MRI because MRCP, because ductal
communication can be seen.
Yeah, ductal details we can better see with MRI. And that is important in further management.
Pancreatic pathology, the CT is better than the MRI.
No, here we are looking only related to the cyst. I am talking about pseudocyst, not other cases.
Yeah, pseudocyst, no, CT will be better than the MRI.
Okay.
Well,
the reason is that you really want to see that whether this cyst which is there, it is has been fused with the stomach wall.
Stomach or not.
Mm-hmm.
And that can be probably better seen on the CT scan, Jay, to decide about your treatment, Jay.
And one more thing, even if it is communicating with duct, I think when you are draining with bowel or stomach, the purpose is already served.
If you are planning for endoscopic treatment, then again, MRI is preferred. If you are planning for a surgical treatment, CT will be preferred, of course. Yeah, please go ahead.
Go ahead.
What next?
We lost him, right?
Harsha?
Yes, sir.
Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Continue.
Sir, I would like to intervene the patient. We can drain the cyst. We have multiple options.
Now, what is your choice? See, we cannot give multiple options to the patient. We'll have to decide.
Yes. Yes,
and tell the patient that these are the ways we can do it and this is what I feel is better for you.
Yes, sir.
So how do you go ahead with that? First tell us what are the various options and second then tell us why you want to choose that option.
Yes, sir. Sir, it could be percutaneous way of aspiration. It could be endoscopic treatment and internal drainage and it could be surgical procedure.
Okay.
Either open or laparoscopic.
Okay. What will be your choice?
According to the CT report in this patient.
First thing is, what is the indication? Why you want to intervene?
Wall thickness guidelines we follow, but patient is having a symptom. Patient is having vomiting continuously since 12 days. So patient is having symptomatic cyst, which is increasing size. Even after admission, it has been increased.
Has he got vomiting now after admission? Maybe he is there for 12 days with you.
Yes. After admission, for 3-4 days, he had vomiting until RT has been inserted.
Okay, but how he has got vomiting now?
No. He is not having vomiting now, sir.
Okay. So in other words, what are the indications of surgery in pseudocyst? Simple.
Increase in size of the swelling, any compression symptom, then
increase in size, I doubt. Yeah, compression. Okay, number one. Yes.
Compression of the structure like the stomach and the biliary tree.
Yes.
Then if there is a intracystic, we are suspecting rupture or any infection.
Okay, infection, yes.
And if it is persisting more than the 6 week and more than 12 centimeter size, 6 centimeter size.
No. Fine. What will you do?
In this patient, CT was suggestive of 2 to 3 mm of thickness of the wall. So, ideally, it is difficult to perform cysto-gastrostomy in this patient. So endoscopic drainage we can go for in this patient.
So if the patient doesn't have vomiting now,
yes sir,
what is the hurry in operating this patient? He doesn't have any pressure symptoms.
Yes sir.
He is asymptomatic practically except that lump.
Yes sir.
So why you want to
It has got a very huge size swelling, sir. So even after admission, patient complained that it is increasing. So it may increase further, and other sequelae of the pseudocyst can happen. So before it gets ruptures or any secondary complication occurs, we should drain the cyst.
No, I doubt. What is the opinion of other professors?
Symptomatology, if the symptoms are present, sir, patient needs to be operated. That is what is the...
Yeah, but he says the patient is asymptomatic right now. No sir, vomiting.
I'm not sure about the vomiting, but what about other symptoms? Other symptoms, not only vomiting. Vomiting is not only the indication. What about the pain is increasing?
He doesn't have pain at all.
So
yeah.
look at the what... He is presenting as 3 months duration and increasing in size. So,
and then why he is in ward still after this many days?
So one not. Hello. So
yes, sir.
Yeah. So now people have waited for pseudocyst for 6 months to 1 year also, sir. So the thing is, symptomatic pseudocyst needs to be treated. This is what it is. Since he has no complications related to this, no hemorrhage or something like that. So if there is no pain, no vomiting, and patient is educated, he can follow up with you.
Wall thickness 2 to 3 millimeters.
Yes, sir.
Fine. If we want to do, sorry.
No, I was asking wall thickness is 3 millimeters.
Yeah, that is what he said just now.
And that's what I don't know.
Yeah. So if it is 3 millimeter, I think you have to wait for that. You know.
Yeah.
You have to see whether it has fused with the stomach or not.
Yes, sir.
And as this patient is asymptomatic for the time being, so we can very well wait for this patient. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
That is what I feel. Yeah. Fine. If at all, if it was suggested that we could have gone with intervention, what would have been your choice?
It could be, sir, surgical cysto-gastrostomy because he. After the CT, we can see the swelling is compressing the stomach. So that approach would be...
Because you are a surgeon?
No, sir.
Fine. What other options you could have considered? Of course, we will discuss surgery also, no doubt.
Sir, we can have endoscopic transgastric drainage or transpapillary drainage.
Can you explain how it is done? Transpapillary and transgastric, how does it work?
With the help of endoscopic ultrasound, we see the...
Yes, we have EOS, yes, most welcome. EOS guided procedure is, of course, better, no doubt.
So, we negotiate the scope and as such, we enter the stomach. We see the bulging, where the actually bulging in the posterior stomach wall of the cyst. Mm-hmm.
Harsha? Yes. Harsha?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me 2 important precautions at this stage? You said you went through the stomach,
yes,
you
sir.
Saw a bulge. Now yes, you are about to incise.
Yes,
now,
sir.
Can you tell me 2 important precautions at this stage before you do a endoscopic cystogastrostomy? I have given a clue indirectly. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Mm. At that stage, when you are making a nick there, no?
Yes,
one is the CT, you would have seen the CT.
Yes,
we can't really make out the stomach and distance here as Khanna sir was all the time telling fused. So what are the 2 things? One is vasculature there, posterior wall of the stomach there. You know, if you see prominent vessels, you should try to avoid, number one. Number two, at least there should be less than 3 to 4 millimeter distance between the stomach wall and the
cyst wall. Yes, sir.
Because if it is more than that, it will not go into that cyst. It will be a leak.
Futile response. Yes, sir.
It's a very important, 2 important precautions you need to take. whenever you are doing that. So you say when you do an endoscopy, you see the bulge, avoid vessels, make a nick there, and CT would have guided you that there is enough, there's no gap between the stomach and the...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And transcapillary drainage?
It is so, sir. We usually enter through the ampulla of the water, where through we open the papilla, papillotomy would be done, and through that we will drain the cyst.
Which cases TPD will be preferred? Any idea?
When sir, there is communication with the cyst, we can easily do it.
Correct. That many times it will respond very well to transcapillary drainage.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and you said something percutaneous. What is that?
Percutaneous, we can have the tube drainage under USG guidance.
Would you like to do it?
It is not, sir. It has the high chance of recurrence and other complications like fistula formation. So it is
not done. If the duct is open, if the duct is communicating, definitely patient will have fistula.
Fistula.
It's really a worrisome thing for us.
Yes. When do you really now, advise external drainage?
Yes.
Pardon, sir?
When do you really advise percutaneous or some external drainage for pseudopancreatic cyst?
When we are confirmed that the pseudocyst is not a malignancy, which is if there is infection present, infective etiology, so we should drain it and we can have culture, and according to that we can start the antibiotic.
Yes, if there is an infection, severe infection, you can drain it outside.
Yes, sir.
Can you, with the help of these investigations, sometimes we do get problem of like cystic tumor.
Yes, sir.
So how do you differentiate? You said endoscopic ultrasound and some other things. So
yes, sir.
Can you differentiate by investigation between these two?
Yes, sir. We can have EUS guided fluid cytology. We can take the cytology fluid sand for the cytology, and we can see there is any CEA level increase or not, is there in a mucin stained cells or not, and amylase level.
Yeah, if CEA levels are raised,
yes, sir.
Quite suggestive to stick to.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. How about surgery now? Tell us something about open as well as laparoscopic surgery. What are the different surgeries you can do in pseudocyst? Not only this case, in general.
Sir, we can have open cystogastrostomy, we can have open cystojejunostomy, or even we can have Roux-en-Y cystojejunostomy.
Okay, how do you do it?
Sir, usually we open the in open cystogastrostomy, we open the anterior stomach wall, and after just getting the open anterior stomach wall, we usually see the bulge which is on the posterior aspect of the stomach, and we can made a stomy, gastrostomy on the posterior aspect, and open we can puncture the cyst, and we can aspirate the fluid, and we can have anastomosis between the posterior stomach wall and the cyst.
What is the common intraoperative complication or even postoperative complication in this patient?
Patient, sir, may have chances of hemorrhage or sepsis postoperatively.
Sorry?
Patient may have chances of sepsis postoperatively.
Okay, didn't get you.
Then there could be
complication. Is there what complication is there?
There could be leakage from the anastomosis.
I'm sorry, I didn't get you. So what do you do to like prevent the hemorrhage? You're not mentioned that step in surgery.
Sir, before we perform cystogastrostomy, we should check whether any major bleeding vessel has been there or not before we perform the anastomosis.
While doing cystodestruction, what do you do to the edge of the stomach and the cyst wall, which is adherent to each other?
I didn't get it, sir.
Have you seen cystogastrostomy?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So when you open the posterior wall of stomach,
yes, sir.
Drain the fluid.
Yes, sir.
Suck it out, remove the debris, wash it well.
Yes, sir.
What next? What do you do to the cyst wall and stomach wall?
Do you suture? Sir is asking.
Yes, sir. We
Yeah. What suture material? How do you suture, and what is the purpose of suturing?
We usually go with the like Vigril or PDS.
What type of suture?
It could be PDS or Vigril.
No. Simple interrupted continuous locking, non-locking. And for what do you need to suture this wall and stomach wall and cyst wall?
So that because continuous drainage can occur.
No, that is one. More importantly, you can prevent the complications you mentioned.
Yes, sir.
One more important is, before you open the entry wall of stomach, you have to palpate the posterior wall of stomach and cyst wall by rolling your hand, and you should be palpating the Ryle's tube, and you should have a thorough enough surface of palpating the entry wall, rolling over the posterior wall of stomach as well as cyst wall.
Yes, sir.
Right? This is what you should do, and then open the entry wall of stomach, then aspirate and confirm that there is no significant bleeding, and then you open.
Yes, sir.
And the purpose of suturing is to prevent hemorrhage. You make the aperture so big that it does not get closed on its own within short time.
Yes, sir.
So, Harsha, what happens if you don't operate on this patient? What are the complications of pseudocyst in general?
Sir, if we don't operate the patient, it can cause a rupture of the cyst, which can cause the peritonitis, or it could be hemorrhage into the cyst. It could compress the stomach and gastric outlet obstruction. It can compress the biliary tree, which causes the obstructive jaundice. It can cause the internal fistulas.
What internal fistulas?
If it perforates with the colonic fistula or maybe duodenal fistula.
That is what we expect. That it gets drained.
Yes, yes, sir.
So it would help the patient actually. What do you say, Shanai, sir?
So it is like it may help, sir, but it may also cause massive bleeding.
Yes, sir.
So I just want to ask one question to you. What is the most dangerous complication? What is the most dangerous complication, Harsha?
Yes, sir.
Apart from, see, you mentioned after surgery, sepsis is the complication. Why sepsis, man? Why? Sepsis will not occur. Is a clean, clean in the sense when I say the elective surgery. Pseudocyst surgery should not get sepsis.
Unless
the suture lines of stomach leaks and it should not happen. Anyway, what are the dangerous complications you are worried in a long-term follow-up of this patient? See, that is the one issue now. Your patient is 3 months, agreed, all the cases, 2 mm, all that is true. Yes. But what is that you are worried now? Is it increasing size you are worried, vomiting you are worried, or anything else?
Pseudoaneurysm formation.
Very important. You need to know pseudoaneurysm formation.
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow, if he becomes suddenly breathless, what do you suspect? Another second complication. Breathless. Not pseudocyst has not disappeared, but breathless. So, pleural effusion.
Pancreatic pleural fistula can be.
Left-sided is
left sided. Yes,
so pleural. So breathlessness and this hemorrhage. Suppose tomorrow if he has a massive hematemesis, what do you suspect?
It could be, sir, left-sided hypertension.
No. Anything. Pseudocyst, such a large one.
Okay.
Yes. Can you think pseudoaneurysm? And yes, then sir. What?
It can blow out into the duodenum and cause.
It doesn't blow that easily into the duodenum duct, you know, pancreatic duct. We are talking about duct, no communication.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So there's a read from that pseudocyst, duct communication, and yes, second part, hemosuccus
pancreaticus. Yes, sir.
Very, very dangerous condition. So yes. Pseudo aneurysm, rupture into the duct, causing massive hematemesis.
Yes, sir.
Embolization is a treatment that time. Embolization.
Sir. Yes, sir.
So you also should know during the conservative line of management to tell the patient these are the, not that you scare him or run away, but you need to keep it in mind, this dangerous complication. Sir, yes, sir. Please take over.
What are the various locations of the pseudopancreatic cyst?
It can occur into the near the liver hilum or into the
there are different areas which are there. What are the different areas where you get the pseudopancreatic cyst?
Common is laser sac. Then
yes, laser sac. Then it could
common.
Be,
then
could be in spleen or duodenum.
Okay, there are four types of the locations which are classically described. It can be a retrogastric.
Yes, sir.
It can be a hepatogastric. Yes, it can be a gastrocolic. Yes, or it can be retroduodenal.
Retroduodenal, yes, sir.
So, depending upon the location, how do you decide about that, what anastomosis you are going to do?
Yes, sir. According
how
to
do you decide?
If it is a retroduodenal, then we can go for cystoduodenostomy instead of other option.
Yes.
If it is in the retrogastric posterior wall of the stomach, we can go for the cystogastrostomy.
Right.
If it is in the head or body of the portion with communicating with the duct, then we can have trans papillary drainage.
That you cannot do intraoperative, you know? I'm asking about, yes, the intraoperative. Okay, if it's a gastrocolic type is there, then in that case you have to go for the cystogastrostomy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now tell, when you are doing a cystogastrostomy, how do you make an incision in the anterior wall of the stomach? Where do you make it and how do you make it?
It is usually vertical gastrostomy.
It has to be on the most prominent part where the cyst is bulging.
Bulging, yes, sir.
Right, and you have to make a transverse incision, not the vertical incision.
Okay, sir.
Because if you make a vertical incision when you are going to suture the anterior gastric wall, then there can be a slight stenosis in that area. So yes, it has to be. It has to be cut transversely.
Okay.
And how much big should be the stoma of the cystogastrostomy?
It could be 2 to 3 centimeters.
Okay, again, remember the rule of 6, which is there. Here also is the 6.
Okay.
Okay, 6 millimeter thickness of the cyst wall.
Yes, sir.
6 weeks time. And here also the 6 centimeter stoma should be there.
Okay, sir.
And you always do the continuous underrunning of that.
Underrunning, yes, sir.
Right. To prevent the bleed from the edge, yeah, which is there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, if you find a lot of blood inside the pseudopancreatic cyst, what are you going to do? You open that. Okay, before opening that, you must put the needle inside the.
Yes.
Okay, yes,
you,
sir,
must put the needle, you know, and see that, uh-huh, what are the contents there.
Yes, sir.
If you find that there is, in your aspiration, is there the blood coming out? Then what you are going to do?
Then we should explore the further areas, that if there is any active bleeding, we can see. Or
no, you aspirate from other side. Preferably, you aspirate from other side. Once or twice, you may get some blood. Unless it is a significant gush of blood,
yes, sir,
you aspirate from other side as well.
Yes, sir.
You know, if you think it is all full of blood, probably you cannot explore that area.
Yes,
if you put the needle from another area, it will be better to just close down that.
Yes, sir.
Rather than, and then take the help of your radiologist. Okay, yes, and because there is probably a rupture of the pseudoaneurysm is there inside that.
Yes, sir.
And you have to take the help of the radiologist in that to save the patient.
And which ideally should have been diagnosed preoperatively.
Yes, sir.
Harsha, one more question. When you aspirate, what is the standard color of the chronic pseudocyst
fluid?
Color.
It is a usually muddy brown turbid color.
Okay, it is a, yes, you are right, more or less is a car engine oil color.
Car engine oil, yes, sir.
Typical, so as to understand that you should not confuse that to blood.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. Yes, sir.
One more thing, you sir said that you make it 6 centimeter large aperture. You have drained the fluid. Now what will you do? Will you suture or do something else? You have drained or sucked out all the fluid.
Yes,
then
sir.
Do the cyst cavity.
Pardon me, sir. Voice was not coming.
When you have drained all the fluid with suction.
Yes, sir.
Then what is your next step to the cyst cavity before suturing? Do you know necrosis?
Yes, sir.
How do you remove the necrosis from pseudocyst? And up to what level do you remove this necrosis? How do you remove? With what help, what instruments you can remove?
We can do marsupialization of the cavity.
No.
Harsha, you have seen operating pseudocystogastrostomy in your unit?
Yes, sir.
Then you must know the sir's Yogesh answer.
Okay, suppose I will give you a tooth forceps,
yes,
Cocker's forceps, or Babcock's forceps, or sponge holding forceps.
What will you use? Yes.
Or with maybe your finger. I'm just giving you a choice. Can you select now, Harsha?
We can have like. Sponge holding forceps.
So what ultimate idea is, you should not traumatize, you know, you should be gentle. So yes. You understand, no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Instruments without catch, you get. I always tell that the scissors or any instrument should be hold with the way cat is holding the baby with its teeth. This is how you should hold. You should not damage, but you should have the grip.
Yes, sir.
And till you get some amount of oozing, you should remove this debris. Not it should be bleeding, but you should have all these debris removed. In fact, sir, he is preparing for his prelim exams. This patient, I have joined this hospital. I have been deputed. I have operated this patient. This patient had some tachypnea and counts and everything was normal. I have operated and patient is very much relieved. There was no sepsis and some turbulent fluid was there, so I continued with cystogastrostomy, even though it was a 2-3 mm cyst wall, but I continued with it and large amount of fluid was drained, debris was removed, and patient is on full diet without drain at present. So patient's tachypnea has been relieved. It was, you can see that it is compressing towards the left diaphragm and it was significantly compressing, and patient had some tachycardia and tachypnea, and patient is very much relieved. Patient had compression symptoms.
What instrument you use, sir? How did you that debris, if at all, if
I had to use swab holder, then gauze on my finger. With that, I removed, and it was almost 8-10 centimeter size aperture I had to create, because there were some locules towards the left paracolic gutter as well as towards duodenum. And everything was drained, and we could expect that it is a healthy posterior wall now, though it was erythematous, but the debris was removed and patient is doing well now. I have joined his unit recently in last 10-15 days. So I have been deputed to another hospital. So, but he is preparing for the exams. He has given third paper of prelims today. So he's not in absolute touch with the patients and wards. But this is just for the information.
And I think it's time to close. Shall we?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Kanagwal?
Yes, sir. I think Kanna sir and Rajgopal sir can give the final comments and then we will close, sir.
So I think most of the things he has done well, but my observation is that as for the differential diagnosis concerned, we should never give carcinoma stomach and liver pathology in this patient, specifically liver patient, one. Second thing is whenever you have no standard etiological factors like alcohol and trauma, you need to suspect then something else. I'm not sure whether COVID itself has caused pancreatitis.
This patient had gallstones. This patient has gallstones.
So that is why when we asked investigation, you should start with ultrasound mainly. First, etiology of the gallstones and then, of course, cyst to all that location. Then, sir, MRI, routinely it is not done because availability number one and reading from the surgeon's angle. But ductal pathology, if you suspect strongly, especially ductal interruption and all that thing, they say the MR also additional advantage to detect the stone in the CBD.
So if that is the situation. If you're planning for endoscopic treatment, MRI will be preferred.
If there's any surgical
treatment, then naturally CT will be preferred.
And one more thing, sir, if it is a chronic pancreatitis with pseudocyst, then also MRCP will help.
Yeah, of course, sir. No doubt.
And so, again, Harsha, the size criteria is not there, but a symptom. See, your patient, if it develops a breathlessness and all that thing, it definitely becomes an indication. Yes, don't say in the examination percutaneous drainage. Why did you tell percutaneous drainage? It has its own indications, no?
Yes,
unless you suspect
abscess. Unless you are suspecting sepsis, yes, and you want to do a damage control.
Yes, sir.
So most easily, commonly done everywhere is cystogastrostomy.
Yes, sir.
So that you need to know properly. Very rarely, cystojejunostomy is done. When the stomach wall is so much separate, the gap is there. There's a bulge in the mesocolon. So you
stomach is towards the lesser curvature. It is shifted right and medially and upwards. You can see only rim of stomach. Then and then you should think of that.
That's all, sir, from my side.
Anna, sir?
I think out these two presentations, Dr. Aviral did extremely good. Though he is our candidate, but I think probably he answered almost every question. Almost every question. He did extremely well today. And Harsh also did quite good. You know, you will always get a case of a epigastric lump in the examination. Always it will be there. Somebody will definitely is going to get it. And the usual differential diagnosis will lie between the whether it is a pancreatic swelling or whether it is a stomach swelling or whether it is a liver. These are three things which are there. Sometimes the colon may be there. Sometimes the retroperitoneum may be there. All those things which has to be there. And you have to, you know, as rightly said, that do not make so many diagnoses. Make only two or three relevant differential diagnoses rather than making a big list of the, which like, again, today in the liver pathology doesn't fit because it is so far from the subcostal margin, which is there. So it should not come in your differential diagnosis. So you have to keep your, in this patient, the differential diagnosis between whether it is a retroperitoneal problem, which is there, or whether it is a pseudopancreatic cyst or a cystic tumor of the, or any mass arising from the pancreas. And as rightly said, that if it is a pseudopancreatic cyst is there, you have to have a very good idea about the surgery for the cystogastrostomy.